You know, in just a few days, we are going to begin our countdown to Christmas. In 2021, World Remit did a study and found Filipinos spend 331% of their monthly income, or an average of 37,106 pesos during the holidays, which technically for us begin as early as September and extend until January. The Philippines had the eighth largest spend out of 15 surveyed, behind households in Lebanon, Canada, and France, which topped the list. So whether you're a business or the shopper, let's get you set up with the latest seasonal holiday spending trends. Joining us for more on this is John Rubio, the country director of Meta Philippines. John, hi. Welcome back. And Christmas is just around the corner.
Morning. Thanks for having me again. Always love coming on here. Yes, I mean, it's crazy. We're almost in the bear month. And as you mentioned from the stat, you know, Filipinos love to shop during this period.
So John, they say that, you know, the best business experiences meet people where they are. So where are Filipino consumers during holidays and mega sale days? How are Filipinos filtering, finding, comparing items of interest? Why don't you walk us through the key findings from the latest seasonal holiday study done by Meta?
From what we've seen, I think a couple of really interesting insights, as you mentioned. The first, I think, is that mega sales days, all these shopping online, all the habits that happened over the pandemic are now, you know, starting to stick. And even as we see people come back offline to, you know, actual retail stores, people plan around the shopping season. The other insight that we found is outside of planned purchases, is more and more Filipino shoppers are actually discovering things on our platform. Take, for example, on the survey we did, about 7 out of 10 Filipino shoppers actually discovered something and shopped on social for something that they weren't looking for. And when you sort of peel the onion on that, 90% of those actually had the spontaneous discovery, and 80% purchased something from a personalized ad. So we're moving from planned purchases to a world of, I'll call it, serendipitous discovery. Just to share a quick personal story, you know, I was researching to buy a small grill. I wanted to, you know, do some barbecuing at home. And it was interesting because of all the, I'll call it, personalized ad infrastructure, I started seeing all these burgers, which is, you know, something you'd probably grill. And I couldn't resist buying that as well. So I think the implications for businesses, you know, is how do you get on this trend and get discovered on mobile social? I'm curious if you've had a recent purchase like that as well.
I have, but I'm not going to reveal what I bought or what I've been looking at. But John, just very curious. So I noticed, because I checked out the report for the Philippines, are people going, you know, it seems like people are going back to the stores, but are you seeing the online shopping, you know, being the predominant way to shop? Is it going to stick beyond lockdowns? I mean, I can imagine this year, 2022, will be the true test, because this is when we really open up.
No, definitely. And I think the good news is that what you just mentioned is true. Filipino consumers are returning to physical stores. Mm-hmm. I've had a couple of chats with, you know, different CEOs who sell, you know, products. And when they talk about people coming back, they said business has never been better. Mm-hmm. And I think the reason business has never been better is because as you see people starting to go back to supermarkets, convenience stores, department stores, which we've all been looking forward to, is that the habits they formed during mega sales days have continued on. So actually both are happening. And I think that's why you're starting to see, you know, this sort of positive impact on the economy. What then happens is that certain things get purchased offline, certain things get purchased online. And what we're seeing online, as I mentioned, is people look at that. That's where they discover something that they weren't planning for. But also, as you get towards mega sales days, people have almost been conditioned the habit of online shopping, looking for deals, maybe some uniqueness. And again, just to share, you know, a personal story is, it was interesting from a Christmas perspective. Last year, my son said, you know, I asked him what he wanted for Christmas, and he goes, "I want GCash." Because I want to be able to purchase stuff online when he sees something. And this year he goes, "Dad, I want exactly the same." So I think a lot of the habits people have made are going to stick.
And I think your son might be represented by this data that Filipinos actually start seriously looking around by November. John, do we know the conversion rate of eyeballs to actual transactions? Do we have data on that?
For us, so I'll look at what we have on our platform. So if I put together, the conversion rates that we're looking at, we see and retain about 70% of our consumers that are on our platforms from discovery to inquiry. And I think what's key is being able to give, as a business, your customers the seamless pathway from discovery to being able to start a conversation on our platform. Because the other trend that we're seeing is more and more Filipinos are wanting to chat with businesses online. So if you look at our platforms, whether it's Messenger, WhatsApp, or Instagram Direct, the ability to provide that seamless discovery, seeing something on your feed, to being able to chat with a business is, I think, a key component of why we're getting such high conversion rates on our platform.
I know that business messaging is also big, so we'll get to that in a bit. But I'm very curious. I know that the report has only been running for 3 years. That's 2019, 2020, and 2021, I think in 33 countries. But do we know yet, John, the impact perhaps of an economic slowdown or even just the expectation of a recession, the impact of that on Filipinos' holiday spending, if at all? Do we have estimates or projections?
So, no specific projections, because I think, we're all in a really new era, talking about all the, as you mentioned, the inflation rates, whether it's here, it's Japan, in the U.S., and how it's all panning out. From what we're seeing is, I think I'll call it, there's varied. Certain, industries, if you take, for example, something like travel, and as we open up, if you look at retail, they're actually doing much better than they have for the past 2 years. And there's a lot of optimism, particularly as we get into Christmas. Now, as you were talking about, what might happen is if we're in an inflationary area, what might happen is people might start saying, hey, maybe I might buy less. But because of inflation, from a total GMV perspective, we're still very optimistic as we head into the Christmas season.
And you mentioned mega sale days how many times during this interview. I'm very curious, Black Friday, Cyber Monday, but here in the Philippines, it's about the double digits, 1-1, 2-2, 8-8. But I noticed, I don't know if our viewers noticed, but there are less of those. It's not every month anymore. Sometimes it's once every 2 or 3 months. Has the novelty faded? Is it starting to wear off, the novelty? Is there a mega sale day fatigue, if I may coin it that way?
No, I agree with you. I think the novelty has worn off. And you're seeing that, as you pointed out, that it's maybe being very selective about when it happens. But I think there's a good part about that, is I think it's shifted from novelty to, I'll call it, habit. And what happens is, you're exactly right, is as we get towards Christmas, the 8-8s, the 9-9s, 10-10s, particularly 11-11, because you mentioned November, and then 12-12 for those that are like catching up on the last minute. I think what has happened is, as the novelty worn off, people have moved to make it more of a habit, and businesses have followed accordingly. So what that means is businesses are saving, they're saving their ammo, they're saving their capital, they're saving their best sales, their best product launches, for as we get towards Christmas. So again, let's say 10-10, as you plan towards 10-10. And, I'll go back to a personal story. My wife has stuff that she's lined up that said, I need to buy these 5 things, and she's going to go, I'm going to wait for the next sale. So yes, I think the novelty has worn off, but it's transformed and transitioned to something more, I'll call it, more regular as we get into the holiday season.
Exciting, interesting insights, John. So I'm going back to business messaging now. You know how our parents and their parents used to use the 1-800 toll-free numbers whenever they want to reach out to a company for any concern? That's so yesterday. So 1960s, to be exact, when it was invented. Today, I know it's all about DMs. I know people sent over 140 billion messages a day over messaging apps. And for the Meta Group, I know there are more than 1 billion users connecting with a business account each week globally. So I guess my question is, how big is the business messaging here in the Philippines? Are Filipino consumers ready for this? And are we delighted by the experience?
Definitely. And I think the reason for that are a couple of things. One is, as you mentioned all those stats, the world, and particularly the Philippines, which always leads any, you know, when you talk about messaging all the way back from when it was SMS, mm-hmm. when it was selfies, we always lead globally, and we're leading as well from a messaging perspective. Yeah. So Filipinos love to message. And what has happened is, from a perspective of dealing with businesses, you just want to, you know, the way you communicate with your friends and family is the same way you then want to communicate with businesses. So what we're seeing is, in the Philippines specifically, about 70% of the shoppers we talk to have moved towards business messaging. Mm-hmm. You know, 60% say they chat with a business at least once every 2 to 3 weeks. And if you look at the millennial and Gen Z, it's actually double that. It's because, you know, as I mentioned earlier, it's so easy to transition from seeing something on your feed to clicking that send message below to then start talking with the seller. To my burger example earlier, when I saw that ad, there was a, it said at the bottom, it said send message. I clicked it. It had an automated bot that then showed me the menu. It showed me what burgers were available, the size, and all of that. And I think that's why, you know, people are starting to do it more and more, because of that seamless interaction from discovering something to being able to chat and, you know, close that sale with a business. And so definitely, business messaging.
Do you make a distinction between, you know, instant business messaging with a human at the other end of the line versus with a bot? Is there a distinction?
I think the distinction is that simpler things that you can put in a database, the price of something, the availability, the sizes, the colors, and so forth, all of those can be immediately automated. I think as you get to more complex interactions, like trying to close a sale expensive purchase, then the human takes over. But what you're able to do is you're able to collapse the time spent from something like a 30-minute interaction to maybe hopefully a 3-minute interaction, which saves money for businesses at the back end because you have more people selling rather than, for example, doing these long service.
I was going to ask about KPIs. What does this mean for the business in terms of gains in customer satisfaction or agent efficiency, marketing and sales improvement? What about the cost, you know, customer acquisition cost or the cost of closing a transaction? Right. What KPIs do we have to prove that this actually works better?
So definitely on cost, because what you're seeing is as you move from someone having to talk through everything and spell everything out, you can do bots to answer most simple questions. We've seen people save, you know, hundreds of thousand man hours in their customer support systems by collapsing the time spent with customers. But I think it's also really important that as you do that, they're able to shift from servicing calls to having their call center, you know, more and more do things like cross sell and upsell, so that at the same time you're saving money, you're also driving the revenue side of the house.
You're freeing up manpower to do higher value proposition there. Final question, John. You know, the Philippines is the social media capital of the world, where users have an extraordinarily high usage time of about 4 hours per day. How big is the Meta community here in Manila, and where do you see that going in the next 3 to 5 years?
Now, while we can't give country-specific data, I think you hit the nail on the head. Is where, you know, Philippines has always been at the forefront of digital. Just for context, and sort of like you can parse out how big our base is here, is we record about 45 million audio and video calls on Messenger just each day in the Philippines. And when you think that, you know, the amount of people that do that is about 1 out of 2, you can imagine how big the community is, with how many people are, you know, just connecting with each other every day over our platforms.
Very big market indeed. Very big opportunities. Exciting times. John, always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you for joining us. Have a great weekend. And we look forward to speaking to you maybe after the mega sale days, after the holidays.
Definitely. Thanks for having me.
All right.